Hello, my name is Ekaterina from Expo Lingua Berlin, and this year we are called Expo Lingua Online. And we are very happy to see that the number of participants is growing. And ja, die erste Veranstaltung, die Eröffnungsdiskussion, wird auf zwei Sprachen stattfinden, auf Deutsch und auf Englisch. Und wir haben heute drei Experten, die ihre Meinungen teilen werden über dieses Jahr, über darüber, wie man anders Sprachen lernt dieses Jahr. Und wir freuen uns auch sehr, euch alle hier zu begrüßen. Und genau, jetzt übergebe ich das Wort an meinen Kollegen Sebastian.
Ja, vielen Dank, Jekaterina. Willkommen für alle zur Expo Lingua Online. Ich bin Sebastian. Wir ja, beide zusammen organisieren sozusagen dieses kleine Festival. Ich freue mich auch wahnsinnig, dass wir hier alle zusammen sind. Natürlich hätten wir Sie alle super gerne auf unserer Messe, unserem Festival in Berlin begrüßt, aber ja, leider haben das die bekannten Umstände eben nicht zugelassen. Darüber waren wir natürlich zunächst mal sehr traurig, aber wir haben dann in der ganzen Vorbereitung dieses Festivals, also dieses kleinen Events, so viel Enthusiasmus und Begeisterung erlebt. Und wir haben auch wirklich gemerkt, dass buchstäblich Sprachen Hindernisse überwinden. Wir haben gesehen, dass der Wunsch nach Begegnung und nach Kommunikation einfach immer neue Wege findet. Und natürlich gerade im Online-Bereich, ja, das wissen wir alle, eröffnen sich da neue Horizonte, die unser ganzes Verständnis von Sprache auf eine faszinierende Weise erweitern. Aber natürlich wird dadurch auch unsere ganze Branche, das wissen wir alles, mächtig durcheinander gewirbelt. Einschneidende Veränderungen kündigen sich an, wieder einmal, deren Ausmaße wir derzeit wahrscheinlich nur ahnen können. Aber ich will jetzt gar nicht lange darum herumreden. Ich freue mich unglaublich auf unsere Veranstaltung und jetzt natürlich besonders auf unsere Redner, die ich gleich vorstellen möchte. Noch ganz kurz vielleicht, wie Katharina schon gesagt hat, der Talk findet jetzt in Deutsch und in Englisch statt, so wie wir switch between English and German. Wichtig ist für euch alle, ihr seid herzlich aufgerufen, euch im Chat zu beteiligen, Fragen zu stellen, Kommentare zu geben. Der Chat ist wie immer unten auf Zoom, dieses Chatfenster. Und da bitte darauf achten, die Option auszuwählen an alle Diskussionsteilnehmer und Zuschauer. So please interact and write your questions in the chat. You find the chat below in the Zoom window. And please choose the option all panelists and attendees. To all panelists and attendees. Great, and now I will give the words to Julia Richter, unsere erste Rednerin. Julia Richter ist die Geschäftsführerin des FDSV, Fachverband Deutscher Sprachschulen und Sprachreiseveranstalter. Julia, du hast das Wort.
Ja, hallo in die Runde. Ich ja, bin ganz begeistert, wie viele Teilnehmer hier schon sich zugeschaltet haben. Vielen Dank für das sehr nette Intro, Sebastian und Ekaterina. Ja, Sebastian hat im Grunde eigentlich alles schon gesagt. Wir hätten uns sehr, sehr gerne natürlich in der Präsenzveranstaltung getroffen. Das ist aber leider nicht möglich aus den bekannten Gründen. Insofern freue ich mich natürlich trotzdem, dass wir hier in dieser Runde zusammengekommen sind, die Expo Lingua heute auf einer ganz anderen Art eröffnen dürfen. Und ja, zu meiner Person. Ich bin Julia Richter vom Fachverband Deutscher Sprachschulen und Sprachreiseveranstalter. Wir sind ein Zusammenschluss von führenden Sprachschulen und Sprachreiseveranstaltern in Deutschland, die sich den strengen Qualitätsrichtlinien des FDSV auf Grundlage der europäischen Sprachreisenorm verpflichtet haben. Ja, es ist im Prinzip bei uns so, dass wir dieses Jahr eigentlich ganz super gestärkt die ersten 2 Monate ins Jahr 2020 starten wollten. Dann kam die Pandemie dazwischen und die hat uns gehörig durcheinander gewirbelt. Wir sind ein Fachverband, der sowohl für den Bereich Outbound als auch Inbound zuständig ist. Und so hat es uns gleichermaßen leider sehr, sehr hart getroffen. Wir haben ein Frühjahr überbrücken müssen mit Hybridkursen, mit Online-Kursen, die Sprachschulen hier in Deutschland, die Deutsch für Ausländer unterrichten. haben extrem schnell und super flexibel auf die Pandemie reagiert und haben neben Online-Kursen auch Hybridkurse auf die Beine gestellt. Das lief alles in Anführungsstrichen einigermaßen gut als Überbrückung. Wir konnten im Sommer auf Zielgebiete, was den Outbound-Bereich betrifft, in Europa federführend zurückgreifen. Und somit konnten wir bis jetzt die Pandemie, soweit es geht, abfedern, natürlich mit den Hilfen, die auch von staatlicher Seite gekommen sind. Um es vorweg zu sagen, es sind in Deutschland alle Sprachschulen geöffnet. Man muss natürlich ganz klar dazu sagen, aufgrund der Einreisebeschränkungen greifen die Schulen im Moment natürlich federführend auf europäische Interessenten zurück. Denn was die Visa-Bearbeitung betrifft aus dem Ausland, ist es doch im Moment noch relativ schwierig und es ist nicht ganz einfach für internationale Studenten ein Visum zu beantragen. Es sind viele Auslandsstellen noch geschlossen, auch im Auswärtigen Amt ist noch nicht alles so hochgefahren, dass man mit den Anträgen nachkommt. Das stellt im Moment eine sehr, sehr große Hürde dar. Nichtsdestotrotz, was den Inbound-Bereich betrifft, wie gesagt, alle Schulen sind offen. Der Unterricht findet in kleineren Klassen natürlich statt. Es ist für uns ganz klar, dass ein Hygienekonzept schon bereits im März, April für den FDSV und seine Mitglieder erstellt wurde. Dieses Konzept funktioniert sehr, sehr gut. Wir hatten bis jetzt glücklicherweise keine größeren Zwischenfälle, was Infektionen betrifft. Die Teilnehmer und Interessenten, die an Sprachkursen in Deutschland, aber auch im Ausland teilnehmen wollen, können definitiv damit rechnen, dass sie natürlich in kleineren Klassen unterrichtet werden, was in dem Fall für den Studenten ein großer Vorteil ist. Aufgrund der Wirtschaftlichkeit wiederum der Schulen wird in vieler Hinsicht auch auf Hybridunterricht umgeschaltet. Das heißt, der Schüler, der im Präsenzunterricht sitzt, wird unter Umständen in seiner bestehenden Klasse mit Schülern aus dem Online-Bereich live zusammengeschaltet. Das nennt man letztendlich Hybridunterricht und dieser Unterricht funktioniert eigentlich sehr, sehr gut. Es ist reiner Online-Unterricht teilweise möglich, es ist reiner Präsenzunterricht möglich und es ist natürlich auch der klassische Hybridunterricht möglich. Um ein bisschen aus dem Bereich Outbound zu berichten, unsere Mitgliedsunternehmen entsenden ja auch deutsche Interessenten ins Ausland, in alle möglichen Länder international. Dem Ganzen stehen im Prinzip keine Grenzen im Normalfall entgegen, was in der Pandemiezeit natürlich ganz anders ist. Das heißt, auch hier haben wir bei dem Entsenden von deutschen Interessenten ins Ausland große Schwierigkeiten im Bereich außerhalb der europäischen Zielgebiete, Schüler in ihre Wunschdestination zu vermitteln. Wir konnten im Juli, August und auch im September noch sehr viele Interessenten auf europäische Ziele umbuchen. Das hat im Großen und Ganzen sehr, sehr gut geklappt. Allerdings ist es natürlich oftmals eine Kompromisslösung, die auch zu kürzeren Kursen führt. Wenn jemand ein paar Monate ursprünglich nach Australien wollte, ist er am Schluss vielleicht für 3 Wochen erstmal auf Malta gelandet. Die Rückmeldungen waren grundsätzlich sehr, sehr positiv. Aber man muss natürlich ganz klar sagen, es ist für alle Beteiligten immer ein großer Kompromiss. Also was die Auswahl der Programme betrifft, was natürlich letztendlich auch die Zeit betrifft, was vielleicht auch den Kurs vor Ort betrifft. Wir haben Rückmeldungen bekommen, dass es sehr, sehr gut klappt, auch von der Hygieneseite her. Das heißt, auch da sollten sich Schüler überhaupt keine Sorgen machen, dass es von Seiten der Hygienemaßnahmen in den Schulen in irgendeiner Form Probleme gibt. Die Schulen sind sehr gut ausgerüstet, auch was die Abstandsregelungen betrifft. Und was den Inbound-Bereich betrifft, hören wir auch immer wieder, dass Agenturen und auch Studenten aus dem Ausland Deutschland im Moment durchaus auch sehr positiv als Option anstreben, um einen Sprachkurs in Deutschland zu machen, weil eben auch hier das Gesundheitssystem sehr, sehr gut ist. Also das spielt uns sozusagen in die Karten. Nichtsdestotrotz muss man ganz klar sagen, das Jahr 2020 ist irgendwo zwischen 20% und 50% Maximum verlaufen. Die Schulen und auch die Veranstalter haben definitiv große Verluste zu verzeichnen. Wir blicken im Moment gestärkt ins Jahr 2021. Wir sind grundsätzlich gut aufgestellt. Wie gesagt, das Hygienekonzept funktioniert sehr, sehr gut im Inland, im Ausland. Wir hoffen natürlich auch, dass es eine Mischung gibt in Hoffnung oder in Richtung Hoffnung aus der Möglichkeit, dass die Medizin natürlich im letzten Dreivierteljahr deutlich vorangeschritten ist, aber natürlich auch im Bereich der möglichen Impfung und natürlich dadurch, dass wir hoffentlich auch lernen, alle ein Stück weit mit der Pandemie lernen zu leben und im nächsten halben Dreivierteljahr es vielleicht einfach auch wieder positive Wendungen gibt im Tourismus, in der Reiseindustrie. Das wäre sozusagen so unsere Hoffnung, denn grundsätzlich ist der Wunsch von Reisenden da. Jeder steht gefühlt in den Startlöchern. Wir kriegen hier jeden Tag Anfragen aus dem Inland, aus dem Ausland. Die Leute wollen, wenn sie denn dann auch nur dürfen. Und im Moment ist es natürlich auch ganz klar so, dass auch politisch von Reisen natürlich abgeraten wird und sich der eine oder andere fragt, darf ich denn, kann ich denn und so weiter. Die Frage können wir natürlich auch nicht beantworten. Das muss jeder für sich selbst entscheiden. Aber grundsätzlich, wie gesagt, die Formate sind da, die Programme sind da in großer Vielfalt, trotz Einschränkungen weltweit, das ist ganz klar. Aber wie gesagt, wenn Beratungswunsch da ist und auch eine Sprachreise geplant ist, dann bitte haltet auch daran fest. Vielleicht muss man sie mal auf ein paar Wochen oder Monate verschieben, vielleicht auch erstmal online starten, vielleicht auch mit einer Quarantäne verbunden, wenn man einen längeren Aufenthalt plant. Aber wie gesagt, es existieren nach wie vor alle Möglichkeiten und wir sind sehr, sehr gut aufgestellt. Ja, jetzt hoffe ich, dass es auch vielleicht noch die eine oder anderen Fragen gibt. Es kommen ja auch noch einige interessante Redner nach mir. Und wenn es Fragen gibt, stehe ich natürlich jetzt, aber auch natürlich während der nächsten Tage der Expolingua allen Interessenten zur Verfügung. Ich freue mich auf zahlreiches Feedback und übergebe jetzt zurück an die Ekaterina und den Sebastian.
Hallo Julia, vielen Dank für deinen Beitrag. Es war sehr interessant, sozusagen diesen Gesamtüberblick ein bisschen über die Branche kennenzulernen. Und vielleicht, maybe we can also switch to English already in the questions, because I saw in the chat that many people are from other countries than Germany. So maybe one question, what is your personal experience in the last few months? I mean, how is your life actually changing, or in which direction you think also then will the whole business develop in the next year, in the next month?
So my daily business changed completely. It's still the daily business as usual, but on top there are many things we have to provide to our members in regards to the pandemic. So it's plenty more work, and also at the member side, there's a lot of more work. They have to change dates, they have to cancel bookings, they have to communicate much more with their international partner schools. So it's a lot of work we all, I think, have to face every day, which came on top, actually. One positive experience I made over the last few months was definitely the great exchange we had with international and national associations. So we got much closer. We exchange on a very frequent base, and I think we can, you know, keep that after the pandemic in the same perfect way we've started and experienced it in the past few weeks and months. So this is something I will really highlight, because this is a great advantage. We learned a lot from each other.
Exactly. I mean, I completely agree, though, also for us as an organizer of normal exhibitions and fairs, it was quite a big challenge to organize this online event, but also we enjoyed it really. And as I told you, it was we realized so much enthusiasm and so much new dimensions, actually, also in the whole development of language learning. So it was a great experience for us. And what do you think about the emotional basic situation of the people? I mean, what do you think? How will it be in the next month? So do you have any ideas or any prospects, or what's your opinion about this?
As I said before, I'm quite optimistically looking into the future at the moment. We all know that the vaccine is in the near future, hopefully. But I mean, you know, that's what we all got from the medias. So I know that a lot of inquiries are coming in and people are willing to travel. I can even see, you know, from my part. I mean, as soon as the borders reopen again, I would go and travel abroad. I'm not very feared, and that's what we feel from our inquiries as well. Even if we talk to our partner schools worldwide and from also, I mean, basically from Germany, we have a very frequent exchange. So there are plenty of students willing to arrive and to start their courses in Germany. They just wait for their visas to, you know, get ready. So as soon as they have the visa, they will start studying in Germany. And the other way around, it's quite the same.
Thanks so much, Julia. Actually, I would like to continue with the discussion. And also, we have some questions in the chat. Get insights, actually, the topic, for example, I mean, really comparing online teaching and normal class teaching. I mean, very interesting. Maybe we don't have really time for this now, but we can continue this discussion and will continue this discussion during the whole event. And of course, also at the exhibition, at the virtual exhibition at ExpoLingua. But now I'm happy actually to announce the next speaker. This is Ian McMaster. He's the editor-in-chief of the business communication magazine Business Spotlight. And yeah, Ian, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Sebastian. Thank you very much, Ekaterina. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming. Delighted to be here. Yes, as Sebastian said, I'm the editor-in-chief of Business Spotlight, a magazine for international business communication for those in Inc. needed to do that in English. Primarily aimed at German speakers. We're based in Munich. Business Spotlight is part of the Spotlight Publishing House, and the Spotlight Publishing House is a media partner for this event, and we're also a part of the Die Zeit Publishing Group in Hamburg. So that's who we are. I mean, we, like everybody else, were confronted with this situation suddenly in March, where literally from one day to the next, it was Friday the 13th of March, we all went home and started working from home. Now, I sometimes say to people half jokingly, for a journalist, it really doesn't matter because all we do is sit in front of a laptop and hit keys, and hopefully in the right order. Obviously, there's a little bit more to that, and other parts of our business are more complicated, but it was amazing actually how well we adapted. And actually, I don't think that's just specific to us. I think particularly a lot of businesses, have actually adapted relatively quickly and very well. And the English or the language teaching business is an incredibly dynamic and incredibly adaptable business. And a lot of you will have gone through incredible changes over the last weeks and months. You know, we started using all these virtual tools that we've now become better at using than we were at the beginning. Sometimes people there, I think, drew the wrong lessons from those tools. They found, for example, video meetings difficult. And sometimes not very efficient. They forgot that their normal meetings were also inefficient and not very good. So it wasn't often the medium, it was the behavior in the medium that was the problem. And therefore, I think we have to be careful that we don't draw the wrong conclusions. If I look at the industry more generally, I'd like to go back to actually to August 2019. It's just over a year ago. Now, some of you might have been there where we had an ExpoLingua event in Berlin. It was an incredibly hot summer evening, and we were all close together in a room. You can actually find the video online. And you look at it now and you think, wow, that's incredible. We wouldn't be that close to each other now, either sitting, listening, or socializing. And we didn't know what was coming, but I remember at the time, by chance, I said something that was both banal and actually turned out to be quite interesting, because I said, none of us will abandon our business model for a change that might come. At the same time, we know that something will come that will be so disruptive that certain players in the market will disappear. There will be consolidation. We just don't know what it will be. And of course, that's exactly what happened. In the same way that nobody saw Facebook coming, which in our case wiped out a magazine we had for teenagers, and particularly teenage girls, nobody saw YouTube coming, which wiped out, certainly in English, the market for videos, because everybody started watching one video type of video only. That was the TED Talks, which ironically later became gave birth to print products. Course books put out by National Geographic Learning based on video talks. So these are the kinds of disruptions that we The point of disruption is that it's not a continuation of current trends. It's something that comes and whacks you around the back of the head while you're not looking, obviously. Fascinating to talk about when it's somebody else's industry, not so fascinating when it's your industry. The interesting thing is that if you went back to August 2019 and somebody had said or told you that within 6 months a virus will have caused whole parts of the economy to break down, and they'd said to you this question: will that virus be a medical virus, or will that virus be a computer virus? Now, I reckon if you'd done that test back then, you would have got about 50-50 for each of those. So what have we seen? It turned out to be a medical virus, which gave a huge boost to everything online, everything digital. If we heard about, as Julia talked about, online teaching, hybrid models of teaching. And the face-to-face model was kind of blown out of the water, but it could just as easily have been, and this is not a prediction, but it's something that could happen, that in the future, the internet breaks down, either globally or locally. In which case, what would we see? We would see the exact opposite development. Suddenly, everybody would be clamoring after face-to-face courses. There would be a huge demand for office space. There would be probably much more travel, etc., etc. The point I'm trying to make here is that it's always better not to have your eggs in one basket, to have a diversified model and to be able to move in the one or other direction. At the moment, those organizations that moved early into online teaching obviously were at advantage because they were already there. They didn't have to start from scratch. But as I say, it could just as easily, I think, have gone in the other direction, at least temporarily. Hopefully the coronavirus will also be temporary. And then we need to be able to adapt to what's coming. And that's not easy to do. And if I said to you the 9th of November, then those of you who know Germany and German history will know that is a very significant event. Numerous important things have happened on the 9th of November. And in a trivial sort of way, it happened again this year. Well, not completely trivial. What happened on the 9th of November this year was the stock markets went up by 5%. And what were the companies that benefited from that and went up by 10, 20% in some cases? It was airlines, hotels, and aircraft makers. And the ones that lost out were Netflix, Zoom, and Ocado online supermarket. Now, why was that? Obviously, because there was good news on the vaccine front. So that just shows you how quickly and how dramatically things have changed. And the players in the market need to, I think, be aware of that and not extrapolate from current trends, or at least not have an alternative scenario that you could turn to. And sometimes people have used the analogy of, said we're all in this together. I've been very impressed by the way that the players in the language market have been incredibly supportive of each other. And so we sometimes say we're all in the same boat. Well, one of our authors, Mike Hogan, who some of you will know, he's been at Expo Lingua numerous times himself. He says, no, we're not in the same boat. We're on the same river, but we're all in different types of boats. And I think that's the kind of analogy. We're all actually affected in slightly different ways by this, but nevertheless, as I say, there's a huge degree of, I think, help and cooperation, and that's been amazingly good to see. If we compare we ran a debate in Business Spotlight recently comparing, asking people to debate the relative merits of online and offline teaching. By the way, again, back in Berlin last year, I suggested that these terms offline and online would become antiquated in 20 years' time. They became antiquated within almost a year because suddenly offline teaching and learning basically didn't exist. When we asked two people to debate this topic, it was very hard for us to find somebody who would say that offline teaching wasn't as good as online teaching, partly from self-interest, which is understandable. Nobody's going to go public and say this is not as good as online teaching. Actually, the only person we found who would say it was somebody at a university who probably felt relatively safe. Of course, the debate is not that one's good, the other's bad. It's about the benefits of both. And what is good in either medium, face-to-face or online, is quality. So hopefully quality will, as we say, out. Quality will win. And it doesn't matter whether that's virtual or face-to-face, whether it's print or digital, it should be quality that wins. That's the rosy view. The danger is that in a situation of situation that we have at the moment, and this was actually present before the coronavirus crisis, was that there's a tension between individualization, which is seen as a good thing, and standardization. And there's huge cost pressures, particularly in the business sector, the business English sector, which is my specialty. There are huge cost pressures from company to get the cost of training down. And standardization, one supplier for all. And my concern there, and it's a concern that relates to face-to-face teaching as much as online teaching, is that in this, in the drive to drive prices down does unfortunately affect quality. And will we be able to deliver the high quality of sophisticated skills that people need to do their jobs effectively? And these are the things like collaboration skills, problem solving, conflict resolution, the interpersonal skills, the intercultural skills. And that's, I suppose, my worry is that we have a drive to drive price down through standardization and that quality does suffer. So I think that's something that we need to be keep our eyes on and be aware of that, and the flexibility to adapt to, as Yulia said, I share your view, Yulia. I think the moment there's any sign that things are opening up, then travel will go, travel at least temporarily will go crazy again. There'll be a huge demand, and there'll be a demand for the personal, the interaction with somebody in the same space, in the same room. So lots of change ahead. Sebastian, you still there?
I'm coming. Thank you, Ian. It was very, very good points, actually. And yeah, it's always kind of it's actually rational to expect the unexpected, and this is very hard for us to understand, actually. But that's it in a way. And on the other hand, I mean, I want to also focus a little bit on the personal point of view and just ask you what are the impacts of all this situation now on your job, on your sector at Spotlight Verlag as a language publisher. So maybe you can tell us some details.
Yeah, sure. I mean, we're affected on the business side, like any publisher, and publishers are affected in different ways. So, I mean, news organizations, at least the quality ones, they saw a huge drive of increase in traffic to their websites. But interestingly, the quality press, including our parent company Die Zeit, saw a huge increase, or it's an increase in there also on the print side as well. So how are we particularly affected? Well, at one level, obviously, when we went into lockdown, this impacted our newsstand sales negatively. There were simply fewer people around, and particularly for Business Spotlight, there are few people at railway stations and airports, which are key selling points. So that's one place where it affected us. Fortunately, our business model is primarily a subscription business model, and that's not really affected in the same way. At the same time, we're also not dependent on advertising, which for some publishers was another great source of losses. So in a sense, we were lucky there that advertising is a relatively small part of our business. I mean, we have lost there, but it's a very small amount, so it's less significant. Then there's the whole question of, you know, kind of print and digital usage. And then it becomes, I think, a much more differentiated picture. As I said, I mean, our parent company, Die Zeit, saw an increase in print sales and also digital subscriptions. And with us, you know, we of course there's a move towards digital, and we're moving in that direction, providing new platforms, which we'll be launching later this month as well, for people to access our material digitally. But I suppose we're lucky in Germany. Germany has a very efficient postal system. If you subscribe to a magazine, it arrives on time usually. This isn't always the case in other countries. So so from that point of view, you know, people are spending huge amounts of their time, as we are now, in front of a screen, and therefore the demand in the evening to sort of sit back on the sofa and take a physical product, a magazine, and have that different feeling has held up well. So in a sense, you know, we're on course this year to be close to our print targets, and so it's not kind of like one or the other. We all dip between these different worlds. So I would say, you know, we, you know, to sort of translate the German expression, it's kind of one black eye that has hit us this year. But other publishers, particularly if they were dependent on advertising or events as their main source of money, or maybe in some cases newsstand sales, have been worse affected. So we're on the river. Our boat is a medium-sized boat, so we're able to avoid most of the waves that come along. But we don't know what the next one's going to be.
Exactly. Yeah, thank you. I mean, I would love to go more in details now. You mentioned so many interesting aspects. I hope you have time. You also have a presentation at our fair, and also maybe are available sometimes at the virtual stand in the exhibition.
Yeah, sure.
Continue this discussion. And again, thank you, Ian. And we are still exactly in time. Then I can. Very happy to announce Steve Kaufmann. Steve Kaufmann is an award-winning language blogger, a YouTuber. He's the co-founder of LingQ, and he's a polyglot. He speaks, I think, more than 20 languages. And I think he was already an influencer before the word influencer actually existed. So I'm really happy to announce Steve Kaufmann and give the stage to you, Steve.
Thank you. Es freut mich sehr, an dieser Sprachenkonferenz teilzunehmen. Ich habe überlegt, soll ich auf Deutsch sprechen oder auf Englisch? But you know, I'm going to switch to English because as I listen to the two previous speakers, whoops, something happened here. As I listen to the two previous speakers, I realized that I would rather, you know, touch on some of the points that they have made in order to be more relevant to the conference. Can I, for some reason, I have lost the picture. Can you still hear me? Could someone just confirm? Yeah, okay.
Yes, we can hear you.
So, привет, да, джао, минасан, коннечива, buenas tardes, and so forth. We are living in difficult times. Our movements are very much restricted, but I think it's a time to learn languages. And certainly I have more time on my hands now, except if the weather is good, I go and play golf. Otherwise I study my Arabic I'm working on Arabic and Persian right now. But you know, the languages surround us. It doesn't matter whether it's English or German or Arabic. We can find them everywhere now, not only in books, but online, on Netflix, YouTube. And so the question becomes, how do we take advantage? And in language schools, of course. So how do we take advantage of all of this to learn languages? And in particular, when we have less opportunity to travel, to interact face to face with people, I think there's an added opportunity to discover the world of language by ourselves. You know, there is a famous Taoist expression, Bu Chu Hu, Zhi Tian Xia. In other words, don't leave your house, you can know the whole world. And this was said by Lao Tzu about 2,500 years ago. Maybe he anticipated the internet, I don't know. But that is true today like never before. We can speak to people through the internet. We can access newspaper articles, movies, and so forth, and incorporate these into our study program. But this only works if we are motivated to discover that world. And I think that's part of what Lao Tzu had to say. We have to want to connect with the world. And personally, you know, languages has always been a passion of mine, partly when I was working. And I had the opportunity when I was working in the lumber business to travel in Germany with my agent when we were stuck in the Stau on the Autobahn, we were able to speak a lot of German. That was really helpful for my German. And at the age of 60, which is about 15 years ago, I decided to undertake the study of Russian. And my main motivation was because people said, you know, my approach to language learning is one of absorbing the language, getting to know the language before I learn the language. In other words, not starting with the grammar, but starting with a lot of input so that my brain gets used to the language, and then the grammar has some meaning. The grammar explanations have some meaning. And I was told you can't do that with Russian because Russian is too complicated. So I said, okay, we'll give that a try. So I, you know, started learning Russian, and I discovered, you know, the world of Russian, the world of Russian literature, and of course, eventually traveled to Russia and enjoyed that. The point I was making is that you have to have that desire somewhere. There has to be this motivation to learn other languages, because when we learn another language, it's not just the language we learn. It's not just that we can say, you know, buenos dias. It's that we discover a different culture. I will always learn the history when I learn whatever language it is, Czech, Ukrainian, whatever. I want to learn the history of that country. I want to travel to that country. So with that motivation, I have learned now 20 languages. That's a bit of a mouthful. I don't speak them all equally well, obviously. I have maybe half a dozen that I can speak comfortably, and then another half dozen that I speak with a lot of mistakes, like my German or my Russian. And then I have other languages that are works in progress. But whatever I know in these languages gives me great pleasure. And if I were to speak in German, I would make a, ich werde sehr viel Fehler machen, aber es spielt keine Rolle. Hauptsache ist zu kommunizieren. Und wenn ich verstehe, was die anderen sagen, und wenn ich kann meine Meinung ausdrücken, das ist genug, auch wenn ich sehr viel Fehler mache. Und wenn ich mehr spreche und mehr lese auf diese Sprache, auf Deutsch zum Beispiel, dann werde ich besser sprechen, weil ich anwende also fast nie mein Deutsch. But the point I want to make is that, of course, we want to speak well and we want to speak accurately, but we can enjoy languages without having that degree of accuracy. And in my experience, the main thing is to enjoy the process, to enjoy connecting with the language. And in my case, I prefer doing that through a lot of input, a lot of listening and reading, getting some familiarity with the language before getting into the details of the language. And I find that very often language instruction tends to put the cart before the horse, because they begin with, you know, a lot of these language books start with, you know, diagrams of your mouth and how you're supposed to pronounce and stuff. And or they'll have international phonetic alphabet symbols. And until you've heard enough of the language, all of this is quite difficult it's almost irrelevant. And the same with many of the fine points of grammar. You know, some of the things that are explained to you, if someone tells you that in Russian, you use one case for one, another case for two, three, and four, and then another case for five and more, like год, года, лет, you can't remember that. You almost don't believe that. And yet, if you have enough experience with the language, these things start to fall into place. The brain has that ability to create patterns. As Manfred Spitzer, who is, I often refer to him, a German neuroscientist, says, you know, the brain can't do otherwise than learn. The brain will learn. The brain creates patterns, but it does it slowly. And so I find that once you've allowed the brain to create some patterns, then the specifics, the instructions become more meaningful. So, but I think getting back to the earlier discussions today, I think there is no contradiction between, bricks and mortar schools, publishers like Spotlight, what we're doing at Link. Link is an online community. This is where I study, but we need content. And so the content that we use, either we have items that we are allowed to share in our libraries, or our members can import, you know, YouTube videos, which we have a browser extension, which enables us to bring the video. And if there's subtitles and the subtitles come in as text, we can use the dialogues from Netflix. There's no limit to the kinds of things that can be brought in. But ultimately, a successful language learning requires a guide. So that guide, someone has to help the learner navigate through the kind of content that's available on the internet, through the intricacies of the grammar, which eventually become, you know, increasingly important as we start to speak more and more. And we have to speak a lot in order to speak well. So I want to stay on time here. So my point really is this: there is tremendous opportunity to connect with language. We can do this during this COVID time at home, you know, without leaving our house. We can connect with the world, build up our capability in the language, and even have online discussions with native speakers. But the goal then is, because we all want to go to the country where the language is spoken. And so if we're working on our German at home, then, or our English at home, then eventually we'll want to go to that country. And when travel restrictions are relaxed, the better we have prepared ourselves at home, the better we'll be able to take advantage. Because when you go to the country, if you aren't already sort of, if you can't land, you know, with your feet on the ground, you won't be able to take advantage of being there. So I think the COVID time is a time to prepare ourselves for eventually going to where the language is spoken, which is the ultimate goal. I think I stayed within the 10 minutes. Hello. Okay, there we are.
Thank you, Steve. Yes, you are exactly in time. Very, very impressing. And yeah, the chat is exploding now in many languages. Very interesting also. And I just, for the first, as a first question, I what would interest, would be for me personally of interest, when did, for the first time in your life, did you realize that you had this kind of special passion and motivation for learning languages?
Well, you know, during my professional career, I was a Canadian diplomat for 7 years. My first assignment was to go to Hong Kong to learn Chinese. But I would say the first time was when I was 16, I spoke one language. I spoke English. And I had a professor, a teacher, and this is so important, the role of a teacher, who motivated me to learn French, to connect with French civilization, you know, La Nouvelle Vague, you know, the movies at that time. I got totally interested in French. And I ended up going to France and I studied there for 3 years at Sciences Po in Paris. And so that was, and then when my employer in the Canadian Diplomatic Service was looking, they were looking to train people in Chinese because Canada was recognizing the People's Republic of China. I had no doubt that I could do it. And I think this is an important point. Once you've learned your first language, you know you can do it. And then the second and the third and so forth. And in the last 15 years, I'm more or less retired. And so I decided I'm going to learn Russian, I'm going to learn Persian, I'm going to learn Arabic, I'm going to learn Korean, and I'm just having a ball with it. Plus, I started Link with my son, so I got involved in language more you know, intensively than had been the case before.
Yeah, it's fascinating. And what do you think is the difference? I mean, if you know already, let's say, 4 or 5 languages, then the next to the step language, to the next language, the next step, I mean, what's... For you, in your opinion, what's the most interesting point there, or kind of?
Well, I think there's two things. Obviously, you know, people often say, what's the easiest language to learn? Well, there's two considerations. One, how similar is that language to a language that you already speak, obviously, right? Spanish, Portuguese. But the other consideration is, how motivated are you to learn that language? And so if you are motivated, then the so-called objective difficulty of the language doesn't matter. So motivation is key. And another thing to realize is that if we only have one language in our brain, then we only have one set of sounds in our brain. We only have one set of structures in our brain. So when we come to a new language with different sounds and different structures, at first we both resist and we find them strange and it's difficult. But when you have 4 or 5 languages in your brain, another language with a different way of saying things and different sounds is much less of a problem because the brain has become more flexible.
Yeah, that's really fascinating. I think, well, we have in the chat, I can check for a moment. There are many, many kind of comments. Many know you, of course, and come to Explinga also via your channel. And what do you say? I mean, you already actually focused on this, but just as a kind of, let's say, finish for our discussion also, what do you think, I mean, the changes through all this kind of situation and crisis now, especially for the area of language learning, I think, in your opinion or in your point of view, what do you think?
Well, I think regardless of whether we are an online school or a brick and mortar school or an online system like Link, we have to constantly adapt. we cannot, you know, close our minds to new techniques, technologies, new opportunities. And I think there will just be increasing sort of cross-fertilization between these different formats. I think attending a school is fun. I interact with other students, I interact with the teachers, but I would still go home and use Link because you have to ultimately, language learning is a personal journey. You know, your teacher can only help you or stimulate you, but ultimately you have to do it yourself. And similarly with publishing, because we need more resources. English is an area where there's lots of resources. Other languages like Arabic, there's far fewer, particularly in the intermediate sphere. And so I think publishers, schools, online resources, they all have to interact.
Thank you, Steve. We are exactly in time. I think it's 45 and we also have to start with the next technical check for the next session. So thank you to all of you. Thank you, Julia. Thank you, Ian. Thank you, Steve. It was really a very interesting session. It was a good start for the ExpoLingua Online. And also, I hope we can continue our discussion and continue our talking and exchange ideas also during the next 4 days at ExpoLingua. And to all participants, thank you that you are here. Join us our next sessions. And I give the last words to Jekaterina.
Yes, also from my side, thank you to all today's speakers. I want to wish Julia stay strong and stay creative. And I'm looking forward to Ian's next talk because I always get goosebumps from your future scene and from your ability to see the future and to analyze the events and to make conclusions in such a way that it is really like shocking for me. And also I wish to Steve new languages and I wish to all visitors and to all listeners, enjoy the time. I'm sending now the link to our exhibition. It's already open and you can visit every stand, every virtual stand. You can talk to today's speakers and you can continue and stay in dialogue with them. But now we really have to finalize and we wish you all great 4 days. See you and enjoy ExpoLingua Online.
Thanks very much.
Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.